Hey, this is Dave DeCamp from AntiWar.com. This is Anti-War News for Friday, September 13th, 2024. All right, the first story at the top of AntiWar.com today. Investigation refutes Israel's claim on Aishanor Agee. So, an investigation conducted by the Washington Post refutes Israel's account of the Israeli military shooting of Aishanor Izi Agee, a 26-year-old American activist who was killed in the occupied West Bank on September 6th. So, Agee was shot in the head by an Israeli sniper bullet during a protest organized by the International Solidarity Movement, and it was a protest against illegal Jewish settlements in the West Bank in the village of Beita. And the Israeli military, this was their thing that they came out with. They said that it was highly likely one of its soldiers shot Agee, but claimed that the headshot was unintentional and that the real target was the key instigator of a riot that was taking place. But this investigation from the Washington Post, which was based on videos, photos, and eyewitness accounts, found that Agee was shot more than half an hour after Israeli soldiers confronted the protesters and 20 minutes after the protesters moved down the road and were more than 200 yards away from Israeli forces, a distance where they could pose no threat. So basically 20 minutes after there was any sort of confrontation going on. And this shooting occurred near a Jewish settlement known as the Avyatar Outpost that was first built in 2021 and was recently given approval by the Israeli government. Palestinian residents in the area meet near the outpost on Fridays for weekly prayers as an act of protest. And these are the people, local residents, who, they're losing their land. They're getting pushed out of their homes by these Israeli settlers. So these weekly prayers have become sort of a protest, and activists like Agee have been going to them to show their support. A local resident who's actually a member of the Palestinian National Council told the Washington Post that the Israeli military began coming to the area to break up these prayers and said, quote, "They suppress us with tear gas and bullets, but the activities continued," end quote. So on September 6th, this is the day that Agee was shot, the Israeli military confronted the Palestinian residents and used tear gas and live ammunition, according to eyewitnesses. The Washington Post said that photos showed some of the protesters throwing stones at the Israeli occupation forces. You can see this picture here of Israeli soldiers up on a hill very far away. This was one of the pictures taken by the protesters. So Agee, who is attending her first protest in the West Bank, this is the first time she's done anything like this. She immediately ran for cover into an olive grove when the violence began. She was shot after 20 minutes of calm, during which the Israeli soldiers were over 200 yards away from the protesters. 200 yards, that's two football fields. You cannot throw a stone that far. And a Palestinian teenager who was about 20 yards away from Agee was wounded by Israeli gunfire, so he was hit as well. So the Washington Post said that the Israeli military did not respond to questions about the incident. And then, as I went over the other day, when Israel first said that its forces unintentionally shot Agee, President Biden backed this claim. He said, quote, "Apparently it was an accident. It ricocheted off the ground, and she got hit by accident. I'm working that out now," end quote. So Biden later released a statement that said he was outraged over the killing and called it unacceptable, but he still repeated the Israeli claim, and he gave no indication that the U.S. is going to launch its own investigation. He said, quote, "Israel has acknowledged its responsibility for Aishanor's death, and a preliminary investigation has indicated that it was the result of a tragic error resulting from an unnecessary escalation. The U.S. government has had full access to Israel's preliminary investigation and expects continued access as the investigation continues so that we can have confidence in the result, end quote. So still giving all this credence to the Israeli narrative. And then I saw later, this was on Thursday at the White House press briefing, they asked I forget her name, the press secretary, Karine Jean-Pierre, maybe, they asked her, has President Biden spoke with the family? Is he going to speak with the family? She said, no, he has not spoken with her parents or anything. She said, some U.S. officials have reached out and there's going to be more calls. But then they asked, is President Biden going to be one of those calls? And she didn't give them an answer. So, you know, it really goes to show the difference when Hirsch Goldberg, Poland, the Israeli American who was killed, who was found dead in the tunnels in Gaza, you know, the next day he called up their parents, you know, so you just see the difference in reaction. Very, very stark. And this is something that happens pretty frequently. Israeli forces killing Americans. All right. So the next one here, the State Department approves $165 million arms deal for Israel. So on Thursday, the U.S. State Department approved a potential arms deal for Israel for tank trailers that's worth about $165 million in the latest U.S. show of support for the Israeli military amid the genocidal war in Gaza. So the Pentagon's Defense Security Cooperation Agency said, quote, the State Department has made a determination approving a possible foreign military sale to the government of Israel of heavy-duty tank trailers and related equipment for an estimated cost of $164.6 million. So this approval is the first step. And what happens when the State Department approves arms deals, it gives Congress, I believe, 30 days or so to block the sale. But of course, that's not going to happen with Israel. It's not going to face any roadblocks. And then the Pentagon said that the deliveries of the trailers are expected to begin in 2027. So these arms deals usually take a few years to be fulfilled. And this sale will most likely be, I'm sure it's going to be paid for using the foreign military financing, which is a form of military aid that the U.S. provides to foreign governments to purchase U.S. weapons. Israel is the one country that they can use some of their foreign military financing money to buy their own weapons that are domestically produced. That's a privilege that no other country that receives FMF funding has. But anyway, you know, to talk about the numbers of this FMF that Israel has available, it's quite a bit. They get $3.8 billion in military aid from the U.S. each year, which includes $3.3 billion in the foreign military financing. And then in April, President Biden signed a bill into law authorizing $17 billion in new military aid for Israel on top of the $3.8 billion each year. And a good portion of that is this foreign military financing. About a month ago, the State Department approved a series of weapons deals for Israel worth $20 billion, including an $18.8 billion deal for a new fleet of F-15 fighter jets. That's another thing. It's going to take a few years for all that to go through. So that money, that $20 billion, hasn't been spent yet. People get confused about like the actual number that the U.S. has spent so far on Israel. But that $20 billion, I'm guessing a lot of it is going to be, if not all of it, is going to be paid for with U.S. military aid, because it's going to be kind of spread out over a few years that the money's actually, you know, paid out. But anyway, so U.S. military aid is required for Israel to sustain its operations in Gaza, which is killing dozens of Palestinians every day. And this aid also supports escalations in the West Bank, Lebanon, Syria, and just all over the place. All right, so the next one here, Israel kills 34 more Palestinians in Gaza. So Gaza's health ministry said Thursday that Israel's assault on Gaza killed another 34 Palestinians in the previous 24-hour period, and 96 others were wounded. The ministry said, quote, Israeli forces killed 34 people and injured 96 others in three massacres of families in the last 24 hours. Many people are still trapped under the rubble and on the roads as rescuers are unable to reach them, end quote. So the ministry's death toll does not account for Palestinians who are missing under the rubble, which is estimated has been previously estimated to be 10,000 Palestinians. That's a number they kind of throw out a lot, but it could be much higher than that. And then it's also unclear how many indirect deaths have been caused. And when we talk about the estimates, like that thing put out in the Lancet, you know, that's talking about indirect deaths. When they talk about that, that's years, you know, deaths that happen, that are happening now, that have happened already, but also in the years to come. When you destroy infrastructure the way Israel did, there's certainly going to be very long-term consequences and effects of that. Israeli airstrikes were reported all over Gaza, in the north, in central Gaza, and in the south. One bombing hit a home in Khan Yunis, killing at least four. Israeli artillery fire killed at least two Palestinians in the Jabalia refugee camp in the north. Israeli forces targeted the Nusayret refugee camp in central Gaza again on Thursday, and that came after the Wednesday strike that targeted Nusayret, targeted a UN school sheltering displaced Palestinians. Initial reports said 14 were killed in the massacre, but the death toll rose to 18 on Thursday. And that strike killed six employees of the UN's Palestinian Relief Agency, known as UNRWA. And so the death toll, the total number of UN employees that have been killed by Israel since October 7th, has risen to 220. Israel claimed that its strike on the school targeted a Hamas command center, but it offered no evidence for the claim. The UN said Thursday that there was no evidence that its employees were members of Hamas. So the slaughter continues. It's almost a year already, which is just unbelievable. Man, you know, wow. It's going to be coming up on the year anniversary pretty soon. So on that very grim note, I want to mention our sponsor for today's show, and that is the Expat Money Summit. And this is the world's largest offshore event, taking place entirely online from October 7th to the 11th, hosted by Mikkel Thorup, who's the host of the Expat Money Show and a highly sought after expat consultant. I've done his show before. He's a fan of antiwar.com. When we're talking about expat stuff, moving to different countries, you know, the state of the world, global tensions, geopolitics is all very important. So that's something that's going to be discussed a lot at this summit. So a lot of you would be interested in it and enjoy it. And you'll also learn things about becoming an expat, or if you are an expat, about the lifestyle and ways to diversify your money, your funds, you know, offshore, your assets and everything, and the ways to preserve not only, you know, your wealth, but also your liberty, and learn everything you need to know about crafting a plan B. You know, so this is, I think it's really good for people who are considering moving, or again, getting a plan B. A country where maybe you could fall back on. I think that's a pretty good idea. And you know, you get all sorts of information about that. What countries are, you know, there's a lot of countries out there that are very welcoming of expats, of people, especially that kind of work online, that can move around. Headline speakers include Ron Paul, Doug Casey, Scott Horton, Tom Woods, Mark Faber, Tom Luongo. To receive your free ticket, go to expatmoneysummit.com. That is expatmoneysummit.com to register. And then if you want a VIP ticket, which gets you access to all these different panels, including one that I'm doing on the risk of World War III, click the link in the description, or if you do it through the website, put in the code ANTIWAR for $100 off. So please go check that out, expatmoneysummit.com. All right, so the next one here. Where were we? What bombs did Israel use on the Al-Mawasi safe zone in Gaza? So this article is from Al Jazeera. The three bombs dropped by Israeli warplanes on displaced people's tents in southern Gaza left three enormous craters and a myriad of questions about the use of such big munitions on such a densely populated space. In the early hours of Tuesday, Israel's bombing of Al-Mawasi killed at least 19 people and wounded many more. At least 22 people are reported missing, assumed to have been vaporized by the intensity of the blast. So if you remember when this first happened, I had a story on it, and the estimate was 40 people were killed. And then the next day, the death toll was revised to 19, but it wasn't really revised to 19. It was the health ministry said that they received 19 bodies from the strike. And when they record their death toll, they're recording the number of bodies that arrive at hospitals and morgues. So they're saying 22 people are missing. And if you look at the aftermath, I mean, yeah, there's huge craters in the ground. So basically, this article says that the evidence shows that it was likely the U.S. MK-84 bombs, the 2,000-pound bombs that were likely dropped on this camp, on this tent camp. They dropped it on tents. The MK-84 causes a pressure wave so intense that, as well as destroying buildings, it exterminates life within a 365-meter radius. According to the UN, the blast can rupture lungs, tear limbs apart, and burst sinus cavities up to hundreds of meters away from the blast site. The crater MK-84s leave behind are roughly 15.5 meters wide and 11 meters deep, in keeping with those found at Al-Mawasi. There's no precise count of people who are in the displaced tents. Al Jazeera estimates that there were about 60 tents in the space that Israel hit. Man, I mean, just think about that, dropping a bomb that heavy on tents. All right, so the next one here, is Israel intentionally attacking aid workers? So this is from Responsible Statecraft, from Steven Semler, and he's put together another very handy list. We recently had a story from him. It was a list of war crimes, potential war crimes that Israel has committed using U.S. weapons, which obviously there's probably countless, there's so many examples, but the things, you know, where you could really find the details, because the State Department is claiming that, yeah, they're probably committing war crimes. They're probably violating international law with our weapons, but we can't prove it. And so he wrote a whole story. I think that he had 20 examples of things where, like, the details are very clear. So this is attacks on aid workers that he put together. And he compiled 14 incidents where humanitarian workers were attacked despite giving the IDF their coordinates and being clearly identified as civilians. So I'm just going to pick a random one here. December 16th, 2023, an IDF tank fired several rounds at the convent of the Sisters of Mother Teresa, part of the Holy Family Catholic Parish compound in Gaza. I forgot about this attack because I've covered the snipers killing those two women a lot and the kind of the siege around the church. But yeah, they shelled the nun convent. And this attack displaced the 54 disabled people who were sheltering there, leaving some without the respirators that some of them need to survive, the Latin Patriarchate of Jerusalem said in a statement. An aid worker was reportedly injured in the attack. Later that day, an Israeli sniper killed two women sheltering at the church, shooting one woman as she tried to carry the other to safety. When others in the church ran toward the woman, Israeli snipers shot them too, wounding several, including two children. Pope Francis condemned the attack, calling it terrorism. So I've covered this a lot, that specific part, but I forgot about the shelling at the nun convent. So, you know, this is an attack. They were sheltering disabled people. There's aid workers there. And it's a Catholic church. Emails between Catholic Relief Services and U.S. Senate staff obtained by Politico show that the Catholic Relief Services, one of the largest Christian aid organizations operating in Gaza, had provided the coordinates of the two buildings to Senate staffers, who then relayed that information to the IDF. The IDF confirmed the location of the buildings that Catholic Relief Services requested for protection. The aid group also provided aerial photos of the facilities directly to Israeli authorities. The Latin Patriarchate of Jerusalem Church said they shared their GPS coordinates with the IDF several times before the attack, and they still attacked it. And again, this goes on. December 28th, 2023, a convoy of UN aid vehicles were shot at by Israeli forces in central Gaza as it was returning from delivering aid in the north. The vehicles were clearly marked with UN insignia, traveling along a route designated by the Israeli military, and had coordinated its plans with Israeli authorities beforehand. And again, it goes on. So these lists that he's putting together are very useful, very handy tools to show the crimes that Israel is committing in Gaza. All right, the next one here, Israeli strike kills three civilians in Lebanon. This article is from Jason Ditz. Israeli forces carried out an airstrike against the town of Kafr Juz in southern Lebanon on Wednesday, hitting two motorcycles that were traveling along. Oh, sorry, it was on Thursday. Hitting two motorcycles that were traveling along the road to the nearby town. At least three civilians were reported killed in the strike, including a child. Rescue workers rushed to the scene of the attack and rescued at least three people who were injured in the strike. Israel did not indicate why they attacked the target, and they've been striking a lot of motorcycles in southern Lebanon. So these continue, and this is the first deadly attack on Lebanon since Israel carried out a drone strike Tuesday against a Hezbollah commander. So there was a lull there. You know, they still could have launched strikes, but they didn't kill anybody on Wednesday. And it's around 600 or over 600 people that Israel's killed in Lebanon since October 7th. All right, the next one here, this is kind of a strange story. Report says that Israeli commandos conducted a ground raid in Syria. So the New York Times reported on Thursday that Israeli commandos dropped into Syria from helicopters on Sunday and conducted a raid against an alleged missile production site. So this was a day Syrian media reported very heavy Israeli airstrikes inside Syria on Sunday, which is when the New York Times report said that this raid occurred, and the report cited U.S. and other Western officials. Syria's news agency Sana reported 18 people were killed in the strikes, while the pro-opposition War Monitor put the death toll at 25. So when we're talking about Israeli strikes in Syria, this is a lot of casualties, you know, to up to 25 dead. I mean, that's a lot. And the sources speaking to the Times said that airstrikes were involved in the attack on the Scientific Studies and Research Center near Misaf, Syria. And that's what the report said was targeted in the airstrikes. They claimed that the Israeli troops entered the alleged missile production facility, obtained information from the site, and destroyed it. So Axios reported this too and said that the Biden administration was briefed on the plan before the raid and did not oppose it. So the U.S. was aware of this. If this went down the way that these sources said it did, again, it's kind of a strange story. It's hard to believe that they could drop a commando team in the middle of Syria and get in and out like that. Israel has not publicly acknowledged the raid. The reports say that they haven't because they don't want to provoke retaliation. Israel has been bombing Syria with impunity for years and years and rarely acknowledges its strikes on the country. So not a surprise that they're not talking about it. But the Syrian side has not confirmed this raid. There were some Israeli reports that alleged that Iranians were actually captured in the operation, but Iranian officials denied those claims. Iran's Mehr news agency reported, quote, "No Iranian forces have been present in Syria in the area mentioned by the Zionist media, and this area is where the Syrian army forces are present," the source said. Accordingly, the claim of the Zionist media about harming the Iranian forces or capturing them is completely false and baseless, end quote. So again, that's from the Iranian report. All right, so the next one here. So I was going to make this the top story, but this topic has kind of been the top story for the past few days. Putin issued a pretty serious warning on Thursday about these long-range strikes. So Russian President Vladimir Putin on Thursday strongly warned the U.S. against allowing Ukraine to use NATO missiles in long-range strikes inside Russian territory, saying the move would put the Western military alliance at war with Russia. Putin's comments came after Politico reported that the White House was finalizing plans to expand the areas inside Russia where Ukraine can use U.S. and British-provided missiles. Then I saw some reports saying that the U.S. is going to give the okay for the British missiles, but not the American missiles. But either way, everything is indicating that they're going to sign off on longer-range strikes because they need the U.S. to give the okay for any NATO missiles to be used because the U.S. is leading this thing, and it could be U.S. intelligence, you know, providing the intelligence for the strikes with the British missiles. So Putin said, quote, this would in a significant way change the very nature of the conflict. It would mean that NATO countries, the U.S., European countries are at war with Russia. If that's the case, then taking into account the change of nature of the conflict, we will take the appropriate decisions based on the threats that we will face. End quote. He added that supporting long-range Ukrainian strikes inside Russia is, quote, a decision on whether NATO countries are directly involved in the military conflict or not, end quote. So not good. And again, you know, I mentioned some of the things I covered yesterday. Blinken very strongly hinted that the U.S. is going to do this, and multiple reports saying that some sort of loosening of restrictions is coming. And one thing that's important, I saw, I'm blanking on his name, but this someone shared on Twitter, one of the think tanker guys in the U.S. Made the point that this isn't just giving a matter of giving the Ukrainians permission to do this. This is a matter of, you know, actively supporting these strikes. They need the intelligence to launch these strikes. And when it comes to the Storm Shadow missiles, the British missiles, there was a German military leak a few months ago that revealed British soldiers are actually on the ground in Ukraine helping fire those missiles. So this would mean direct participation in these strikes inside Russia. And, you know, we've already seen U.S. missiles and bombs being used in Kursk. At least Ukraine claimed that they have been used. This would be long-range strikes, you know, deeper inside Russia. So this is a huge deal, and it's really what they're flirting with here is, you know, nuclear war, war with Russia. That would mean nuclear war, World War III, all of the worst things you can possibly imagine. So let's hope someone somewhere gets their senses in them and backs down here on the U.S. and NATO side. All right, so the next one here, Russia launches counteroffensive against Ukrainian forces in Kursk. Russian forces have begun launching counterattacks against Ukrainian soldiers in Russia's Kursk Oblast, where Ukraine launched a surprise invasion on August 6th. The Russian Defense Ministry said Thursday that over the past 2 days, Russian forces recaptured 10 settlements in Kursk. Ukrainian officials have previously said that Ukrainian soldiers had captured 100 settlements in Kursk since August 6th. Zelensky acknowledged the counterattack in Kursk and claimed that the counteroffensive was actually part of Ukraine's plan. This is apparently his master plan is for Russia to launch a counteroffensive. He said that it's the first part of his victory plan, is this counteroffensive. Now, maybe he's saying, because a big part of the idea here was to distract Russia from the east, from eastern Ukraine. And I think they hoped that Russia was going to divert a lot of resources to Kursk to push this thing back right away. But they didn't. But now they're doing it. But the thing is that they've been advancing. You know, I don't know if they even diverted anything from that front, but they've been advancing in Donetsk more rapidly since this Kursk invasion was launched. So, you know, they could say this was a psychological win for Ukraine, because it certainly has that effect. You know, it was an embarrassment to Russia. You have a lot of Russians, and this is something that we see Ukrainian officials and MI6, the head of the MI6 said this, that, you know, they're bringing the war to the Russians, to the ordinary Russians. So that certainly has an impact. But when it comes to, like, strategically here, you know, this was their big kind of a last shot effort to get some territory. And now it looks like if the momentum is now on Russia's side in Kursk and they push them out, then they're going to not have that territory for leverage, and they're going to not have the territory in Donetsk anymore that they continue to lose. But anyway, that's pretty much it. I just kind of summarized this article. But I mentioned, again, the thing that... So this happens right after the CIA and MI6 praised this invasion. So we'll see. You know, this could still take some time. And you never know what could happen in this war. It's been a tough one to predict. But it's still just this one area. I mentioned this yesterday, kind of on the Ukraine's left flank here, that Russia looks like they pushed back. So we'll see if they continue. But, you know, the long range strikes could really change things. You know, you think about potential escalations that Putin could do short of, like, attacking NATO. I mean, he's shown that he doesn't want direct war with NATO. He has all the pretexts in the world to launch an attack on NATO if he wanted to. But he hasn't done that. He doesn't want to do that. So, but I'm like, what is the escalation in between what the situation is now and attacking NATO? I don't know. Maybe targeting Ukrainian leadership or something like that. Or, I don't know. But anyway, The last story here, China and the Philippines agree to keep talking on Sabina Shoal. So this article is from the South China Morning Post. And it says that China and the Philippines have agreed to keep talking about this disputed shoal where they've had these collisions lately. It says that they had a round of high-level maritime talks that were candid, and they both agreed to continue the conversations. That's basically the gist of this story here. But I don't know. You know, I think it's good that they're talking, but it doesn't seem like the diplomacy has really done anything to ease the tensions in general. But again, it's still always good to see talks happening. And this is, so I believe there's been three collisions by this shoal just in the over the past few weeks, and a couple other kind of confrontations. And this is, you know, the U.S. comes out and always tells the Philippines that if your boats come under attack in the South China Sea, we got your back. We're going to intervene. I mean, it's a really kind of volatile situation that we have here in the South China Sea. All right, so that is it for the news for today. Please go check out our viewpoints. One from Jonathan Cook. Israeli torture chambers aren't new. They provoked October 7th. One from Judge Napolitano. Free speech in the Department of Political Justice. I think I mentioned, I know I mentioned that I saw him speak at the Ron Paul Institute conference, but he is a great speaker. I got to see if they posted the speeches yet, but he's just a really good, you know, entertaining speaker. He spoke at the student conference that I spoke at as well, and then he spoke at the main thing, which was filmed, which was recorded, and they're going to post if they haven't already. But yeah, he's just a great speaker. One from Ian Proud. Will Kursk be a sideshow that turns into tragedy for Ukraine? One from Ted Snyder. Double standards reveal the true Western strategy. And one from James Carden. Cheney mania seizes the Democrats. Michael Tracy has been going around asking Democrats about the Dick Cheney endorsement of Kamala Harris. And it's funny, a few of them I've seen say, well, you know, it goes to show that we're, you know, no matter who you are, you know, it's like unity, but it's like acting like Dick Cheney is like some ordinary Republican voter. You know, it's just completely crazy. So go check all that out. That is it for me for the week. I will be back after this weekend. I hope everybody has a good one. You could always support this show, like, subscribe, comment, share it around, all that stuff really helps. I'll be back in a few days. Thanks for listening.